I have the proud honor of introducing Lucy Bernholz. I'm so thrilled to have her here. She has made it cool to be a philanthropy wonk, as she describes herself. She writes extensively on philanthropy, technology, innovation, and policy in her blog, Philanthropy 2173. If you don't read it, start, and you'll be all the smarter for it. I'm an avid fan, and I read it every single day, and I do mean that, and I love it. She's a visiting scholar at Stanford University Center on Philanthropy and Civil Society, is on numerous boards, on numerous advisory. I'm going to stop because without further ado, please welcome Lucy Bernholz.
When somebody is in the position that I'm in right now, they come up here and they tell you about whatever it is that they think about all day, and maybe they'll draw some connections to whatever it is that you think about all day, and if you're lucky, there actually are some connections between what they think about all day and what you think about all day. But when I was getting ready to come here, I actually realized that I could do that one better, I hoped, because I'm actually here to tell you what it is you're doing. So I figured it out, if you've been trying to figure out what you're doing, and I'm gonna share that with you. I am the proud bearer of a Twitter moniker called a philanthropy wonk, and I think I'm the only one, although yesterday I met a philanthropy geek, but we're very different. I spend my days, and I have for the last 20 some odd years, thinking about what's public, what's private, and who decides. And that's what led me into philanthropy, and that in some ways is also what's now leading me out of philanthropy, although I still have one foot stuck in it. And as I think about this question, that question, what's public, what's private, and who decides, in work that I'm now doing at Stanford, but that I've really been doing in a variety of ways over the last 20 years. I started trying to make sense of it on an annual basis. Kiki was nice enough to mention the blog, but on an annual basis, I published this blueprint. This is the fourth one, note to self. When somebody says, why don't you write something, say, okay, I'll write one of them. Not, okay, I'll write it every year, if you ever want to get your life back. But there it is, the fourth one. They're available for free. He can give you the link. And what we've sort of come to as I've been watching and participating and being part of the changes in philanthropy over the last 20 years is that we are actually really reinventing good with the actions of things like what Full Circle is doing. And what we're creating, what Full Circle Fund and each of you individually and collectively is part of, is building a social economy built on data and aimed at change. And that may sound like just a lot of big words to say the nonprofit sector, or what's been called the independent sector, or what's been called philanthropy, but in fact, it's really significantly different than that. And you're actively making that happen. So let me just give you, I wanna take my 20 minutes to say really a little bit about the social economy frame, a little bit about the data frame, give you some examples of what this looks like, that some of which I know you're familiar with, some of which may be new to you, and that I hope will really catalyze your 2013, your next year, the year ahead of it, as you see the potential that you're part of something quite significant right here in the Bay Area in California. You're actually part of really reinventing the way we do good. So what is the social economy? Each of us is a doer and a donor. And this is true not just of the people in this room, but of people all over this country and all over the globe. When we think about donors, we have, in philanthropy-related conversations specifically, thought about them exclusively as people who give money away charitably. But the fact of the matter is, over the last 10, 20 years, and accelerating now, We have started individually, those of us of modest means as well as those of us with significant means, to think not about the pocket where the money sits first, but about the problem we're trying to solve, and ask ourselves, what are the best resources to bring to this? Should I bring to this my charitable giving? Should I bring to it my political giving? Or should I bring to it my investing dollars? And it's that mindset that's both driving the growth of impact investing, which I'm gonna assume is a term you're familiar with. Tell me if it isn't. Anybody not familiar with the term? Okay, I'll come back. Impact investing is actually using your investing dollars that you would normally seek just to secure financial return to also produce social and environmental goods. It's very much on the rise right now. And political giving has long been a part of this dynamic, a hush-hush part of the dynamic. And with the Supreme Court decision in 2010, the Citizens United decision, the election we just went through, 2010 decision, 2012 election, super PACs, and all of the money that went into the presidential election, the ability and the rate at which we use our political dollars to try to influence social systems is on the rise. It's becoming more visible. It's becoming, in some people's minds, more nefarious. It's becoming a problem, but it's very much a part of this calculation. And when you think about what are the solutions that you want to donate your resources to be part of. So that's the donor side of that doer-donor thing. The interesting thing is the doer side. Because if the old model was nonprofits and philanthropy, just as there's been this explosion of ways to actually give your money, there's an explosion of ways to think about how you organize yourself to make the change happen that it is you want to see. So nonprofits are still a big part of this social economy, but you're also, many of you may well be involved in corporate social responsibility activities at wherever it is you work. Some of you may have started businesses that have an explicit social purpose, something like a method cleaning company or a give something back office supply store. These are companies, they are commercial enterprises that were deliberately started to do social and environmental good. There's now in California three corporate designations for these things. They can be B corporations. Everybody heard of B corporations? Mm-hmm. They can be flexible purpose corporations. They can be L3Cs. In other words, in just the last 4 years, we've seen literally, this is a very exciting thing if you're a wonk like me, literally a revolution in corporate code. I found it thrilling. It was good for me. My company was an inaugural B Corporation. It was a new corporate form changing the laws to let us do the things we wanted to do with the kind of enterprise form we were trying to run.
So what does it mean?
Pardon me?
So what does it mean?
What does a B Corporation mean? It is a commercial enterprise that has chartered into its existence the production of a social and environmental good and a public accounting of producing those goods. And there's an accountability system and there's an audit, and it allows you to attract certain kind of investors and not other kinds of investors. It is a gray area, if you will, between a choice that a lot of people were making that they said they didn't want to make anymore, which was, I got to be a nonprofit or I got to be a for-profit. Now, I'm not going to give you a lecture on social finance. I can come back tomorrow and do that. But let me tell you that this is really something. There's $2 billion in revenue in the companies that are chartered as B corporations. There's probably close to about 1,000 of them at this point. It was 700 something last time I looked. And they're only 4 years old. So what's the most exciting thing on this slide? Not the B Corporation. The most exciting thing on this slide is that purple thing called not invented yet. Because you're the ones who are going to invent it. We are all the ones. This is what we're building, is the not invented yet form of enterprise that will be financially sustainable, socially productive, environmentally safe, and that will actually be the place, or one of the places, because these other things probably aren't going to disappear, one of the ways we come together as communities, local and global, to make good happen in the 21st century. It will be the ways we organize ourselves to use our private resources for the public good. What is it? I don't know. It hasn't been invented yet. But we're in the process of inventing it. Because all of those up there, with the exception of the yellow informal network thing, which I'll say just a minute about, are primarily analog institutions. Even as exciting, and I saw that thrill on your face, as exciting as a revolution in corporate code is for people like me, it's still a revolution in something that's been around for about 500 years. The stuff that happens digitally has not been around for 500 years. It hasn't been possible for 500 years for us to do some of the things we can now do in informal networks, managed through our cell phones, which I inconveniently left over there, that doesn't involve any kind of enterprise form. But boy, can we make some change happen. But there's no institution. That's going to lead to all kinds of interesting things. And the combination of the dynamism between those things and those things is how I know that the not invented yet is going to be the most exciting part of this. So the whole structure of how we work together is changing, and you're part of that. What's driving that change? Well, lots of things are driving that change, but the most exciting, and I think the most resilient thing that's driving that change, and we're not there yet, this is where we're headed, is to something I call data-first philanthropy. Now, you guys are all, how many of you have a cell phone in your pocket? Shock. Does anybody not have a cell phone on them? All right. Did you forget it? The cell phone is sort of the tangible representation of how data first has changed so many things in our lives. The best and easiest metaphor or analogy here is the difference between traveling someplace with GPS versus back in the day when we had to fold the map, right? GPS, Google Earth, all that kind of extraordinary mapping layer stuff, that's all data that's incredibly intuitive for us to interact with, even those of us who are trained as historians, so we have the technical chops of this chair, can use GPS, can, you know, recalculate our route or argue with her when she tells us to recalculate our route. We are still in charge. She's got the data, but we've got the steering wheel. But it changes how we see the world. It changes how we make plans. It changes where we're willing to go. It's data first navigation. And we're not yet at, and this is true when you think about making dinner plans in a community you've never been to. It's different, it's changed how we find things to read. It's changed, I've had two or three people say to me, oh, I know you from Twitter. It's changed how we have social networks. There's a data level underneath those interactions that's not a scary data level like, oh my gosh, she's gonna make me do pivot tables. It's not, it's very friendly, it's very easy to use. It's completely pervasive and it's fundamentally changed the way we do basic everyday activities. What we haven't gotten to yet is the point where it starts to change significantly the way we do our philanthropy or the way we use those private resources for public good. But we're getting there. We are getting there. This organization, actually, and I was talking with Mark during cocktails, Mark Smolowitz, who's right there, and I'll point him out. Because 5 years ago, 4 years ago, a group of Full Circle funders recognized that data really mattered as sort of an infrastructural element to thinking about how to do their giving. And they launched something called the Nonprofit Mapping Project, which got a little bit of traction and went a little ways and sort of, you know, not everything takes off. Some things are ahead of their time. But it's now, boy, do we need it now. It was an effort to make sense of the nonprofit community here in the Bay Area by scraping data off of websites of the state's attorneys general, something that you could do now in a minute, and the attorneys generals are meeting next week. I happen to know that because I'm going there, to talk about how they could make it easier for folks like Mark and a group of people in San Francisco to do that 4 or 5 years ago, too soon, but we're getting there now, where you'll be able to have the information you need about who's doing what, not just nonprofits, but some of those other forms, the B corporations, the social entrepreneurs, in the issue you care about, and how can you interact with them? that's going to be a real shift in how we start making change happen, because underneath it is this shared data level. But I want to say just a couple of things, but I'll give you a couple of examples of how significantly I think that data first level is going to help us shift the frame. So we are in this sort of icky adolescent moment. Anybody remember being a teenager? It wasn't all that much fun, right? You know, acne and hormones and curfews and stuff like that. But we're in this icky adolescent moment where we still tend to think that the organization, the enterprise, is at the center of doing the good stuff. And it may sit, it may be part of working on an issue, it sits within a system, but most of us are sort of focused on keeping the lights on, making the organization run. When you start to work off of a data infrastructure, this starts to change. I give you some examples, and it changes at all three of these levels. How many of you are familiar with the organization Do Something? Okay, so you're pretty familiar. A lot of hands went up. It's an organization that works with teens around the country, mobilizing them on various social actions. And the interesting thing about Do Something is it really was started as sort of your normal nonprofit and was using a lot of text messages and helping to organize teens to do something. But what's happened now, if you look at them and what they're doing, really the heart of Do Something is not anywhere near the office in New York. The heart of Do Something is those mobilizable tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of teens who are together, this kind of mob. They mob as teens do in small cliques. But what the organization Do Something does is reflects to them their messages, their interests, their data in such a way that a small clique of teens activated around teen pregnancy or some issue in Peoria is essentially able to learn from a set of teams somewhere else, and that they become connected and they can reflect and work with each other, and it really does become this activatable network that's being activated not by the headquarters in New York, but by the teams themselves. And the staff of Do Something are not driving this movement, they're reflecting the movement to the movement. It's a remarkably, and requires a totally different set of structures and skills. So that's had a huge impact on the organization. Another example of when the data lead and there's no organization is what happened almost 1 year ago this Sunday at last year's Super Bowl, when a bunch of really pissed off, mostly women, but an awful lot of men, who cared deeply about the issue of breast cancer, said, you know what, Komen, if you don't get those damn pink socks off the football players and stop claiming breast cancer as your issue, we're gonna take you down. And there was an effort called Take Back the Pink. It was essentially an effort to jump the hashtag. Nobody knew what that meant, but it sounded very good. Like, we all wanted to jump the hashtag, the Fonzie and the shark, right? Jumping out is the idea was to literally redirect the Komen Foundation's very expensive, very well organized, very centralized, top-down pinkifying of the NFL to get out the breast cancer message, because people were really angry about some stuff that had gone down with Komen and its funding decisions and blah blah. I won't go into that whole story because I got 5 minutes on. There was no organization involved in it. The only thing connecting that effort was data. Was Twitter hashtags and a bunch of really motivated individuals who took the hashtag that Komen had set aside and sort of co-opted it during this football game that, oh, I don't know, about a billion people pay attention to. The Komen Foundation, and I don't say this as, you know, this is what you should be about, but in this case, the anger was really directed, and the Komen Foundation is still trying to get back on its feet. But the forces working against it, there's no there. Because they're just individuals using phones, finding each other and organizing their message. That has huge implications for how change happens going forward. I got not enough time here, but On the system front, when you start thinking about data to shift the frame, the data become incredibly important. And the easiest, sort of furthest along example of this is the rise of the impact investing movement, which I mentioned a few minutes ago. Impact investing is a business model, is a very structured capital markets approach to redirecting significant amount of money into trying to produce better educational outcomes, better social outcomes, better environmental outcomes. This is a metric driven, you gotta have a denominator and a nominator and all that kind of stuff. You better be able to give them an algorithm kind of thing, and they're talking billions of dollars. That whole system, the whole idea, the whole movement, all of the money around it is going nowhere without comparable, shareable, open data systems. That's what's building it, that's what's underneath it. Nobody but me talks about it that way because data is a boring word, but that's what's driving that change. And it could potentially, go back to my little spaceman picture, it could have a really significant impact on where the money comes from for social benefit. And it's data at its root. The last thing I want to say about this is there are probably people in this room who know a ton about data analytics. I just talked to somebody. And it's incredibly exciting to think about what we can do with data to help people mobilize action. It's incredibly interesting. And the potential is enormous. And there's probably pitfalls. But the key thing to also understand about data is that not everybody gets it, not everybody has it. Not everybody knows how to use it. And it will be a shame, and it will ground these efforts on the shoals of past predictable failure if we don't use this moment to make sure that we use the data moment to reach out to people, not to exclude people. That if we sort of recreate the power divides that money has allowed us to build around data as the resource, we will not solve the problems we care about. The only way to solve a problem, the only way to solve a community problem, is to involve the people who will be affected by the solution. It is the only way to do it. And if we don't use the data, we don't think about our data as that kind of connective tissue. I don't care how good your analytics are, I don't care what kind of visual graph you can show me, I don't care about any of it. It has to be a measure of a process of inclusion, or it's just a waste of time. What we'll do all together is shift the frame. I forgot to quote my fancy graphic there before. So here's what it's all about. You put this together, and what you're working toward is data-first philanthropy as part of the social economy, making change that you care about. And ultimately, 100 years from now, folks will be talking about how the people of this era reinvented good the same way we at this moment in time talk about how Rockefeller and Carnegie invented the modern foundation. It was just about 100 years ago from us. It is time to reinvent the system, and you are very much a part of that. Thank you. So this mic over here.
Good evening, Lucy. Thank you. Could you give an example of a philanthropy effort that is capitalizing on this, that is kind of a front runner, that can make this come alive? Something that you see happening already that's a...
This lead, being the social economy and the data
it's the
stuff.
Yeah, organization
through so
philanthropy.
So one of the organizations highlighted in the film was the, Serum?
Yep.
That's very cool. That's a great, very cool. And she talked about it in her little clip. Is the woman in the video in the room?
Yeah, I don't think so.
Okay. So she talks about the need to get to really make the most of those medical supplies and not sort of lose them to the waste bin and all of that. Think about what happens to people who have chronic medical needs in a disaster, right? Their house, take Hurricane Sandy. You're losing your house, you're losing your neighborhood, you're trying to stay alive, the lights are out, they may be out for weeks, the power's out, power may be out for weeks, and you need insulin every day or an asthma inhaler every day. There's no gas, there's no pharmacies, there's no nothing. There is an organization based in Santa Barbara called Direct Relief International, which has a license, I think it may have the only license in this country, to provide medical supplies to people post-disaster without prescription. Right? So they have that authority to get stuff to folks who have that chronic supply. So in 3 days when your oxygen tank is gonna run out, right? That is no easy feat. You gotta get the oxygen, you gotta get the asthma inhalers, you gotta get the insulin, you gotta get the right number of those things, and you gotta get it into a literal disaster zone in what, 24, 48, 72 hours, or it doesn't work. Well, working with a big data company based down in Nevada, down on Palo Alto, that they've been working with for a long time, not only was Direct Relief International able to use the data that was available from public data sources about where the clinics were, what the rates of asthma were, what the rates of diabetes were, you know, pulling together all these different data sources in real time, literally while it is raining, and identify almost to the apartment building, not quite to the apartment building, but pretty much to the block, where those supplies needed to get to. Now, they had to get them there. So how did they get them there? Long-standing relationship with Federal Express. This is great. They, you know, Federal Express knows how to do this, so does UPS, logistics. They, you know, get the right boxes on the right trucks, and they had the right planes, and they get everything moving in the right direction, only to discover what happened in New York, Long Island, New Jersey, after the
Couldn't get the boats in.
There's no gas. There's no gas. So how are people, I don't know if any of you were directly affected by this or involved in watching or whatever, what were people doing, local people doing about this gas situation, you know? I can't hear you.
Sharing.
Standing in line,
tweeting, Facebooking, using social media to create a brand new real-time data stream of where there were gas stations with gas. And Direct Relief International was able to pull that information in as well while it was happening and redirect the FedEx trucks and get the asthma inhalers and the insulin and the oxygen to the people who needed it. Now, it's a perfect mix of big established public data sets from community clinics and the NIH and CDC and all that stuff. That's where they got one set of the data. But when it really started raining, what they needed was the real-time data that people were recruiting on the fly by mashing up tweets and open mapping platforms and making that information available. And then some organization with some very skilled people in Santa Barbara was able to redirect that. And they saved countless lives and helped a lot of people whose lives had really become really miserable really quickly at least be able to get their basic medical needs met. How's that?
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay.
Great. Thank you, Lucy. I'm very good at the